the sessions yesterday and today. I saw a lot of people joining yesterday, but also today. So they're really spending their free time to get and learn. And also thanks to all the presenters who wanted to share their knowledge. I think it's an amazing event until now, right?
Well, look, you make it amazing, you know? The speakers make it an amazing event. And yes, so thank you.
Well, I'll start today with organization hierarchies. It's mentioned Dynamo 365 Financial Operations and AX2012. But in fact, the same also applies for the human resources. However, not everything is applicable, but large parts of it does. For the ones who don't know me yet, my name is André Arnaud de Calavon. The name is French, but actually I'm Dutch from the Netherlands. I'm an MVP on the business applications as of October 2013. And in my working career, I'm currently a product manager at 2Increase. I have to mention that everything I say today is on personal title. So it's not related to my work or my company. I started my career in 1996, initially on Navision Financials, which is now Business Central. But as of the last year, I also started to looking again at the features in Nav and Business Central to see if we can create products as 2Increase is an ISV solution, ISV partner. To see if we can also create solutions which are more application independent. So I have to also look at multiple other areas. And as of 2001 until now, I started to work with, at that time, Damhai Daksapta, which became Dynamics AX and now Dynamics 365 for Finance and Operations. There are some contact details where you can find me. And if required, I can also share it afterwards in the meeting chats. And besides all of this, I also started a YouTube channel called Dynamicspedia a few months ago. So if you like, you can have also look at some videos and subscribe to my channel. And then over to the real contents of today. I hope that we can, or that I can learn you what are the organization hierarchies in the system, how it's being built, what entities are part of that organization hierarchy, how you can use the standard features which are already related to it, and also how you can extend the organization hierarchies to be used in several scenarios for different use cases than provided by Microsoft out of the box. But first, I will start today with architecture, then also make a small comparison between what is the organization hierarchy and what is the position hierarchy in the application. Talk about the different purposes. Also, related to the financial features, what can we do and achieve with the organization hierarchies and the internal organizations? Also, then an example at the end with a demo where I also extended the organization hierarchies, used the extensional data security, including organization assignments on security roles to achieve data security based on organization hierarchies set up. I think it's a quite cool demo. But first, we start with architecture in the system, and then we have to also make a link to the global address book in the system, where it all starts with a certain party. A party in the system we know as either a person or an organization. And every party in between, we can set relationships, like this is a child company of an enterprise or related to persons. This person is the spouse of another person. But as of now, there's no hierarchy related to that. So you can make internal relationships to get some visibility, but that's not related to the organization hierarchies. So one step deeper, when we look at the organizations themselves, we can split them up in external organizations and internal organizations. External organizations could be a customer, a vendor, or a prospect, or even a competitor, for example. But if we talk about internal organizations, then we talk about legal entities. We talk about operating units in the systems and also the teams. The operating units themselves can be further divided into business units, cost centers, departments, a value stream, and retail channels. If you look at development environments of from Microsoft Dynamics 365 for finance operations, then you also see other operating unit types like a region. Those are not part of the standard application. You don't find them in your production environment. It was based on a sample application related to the fleet management example in the system, where Microsoft wanted to provide some explanation how you can develop in finance operations, or what form patterns are used and how to extend it all. That's so the additional three used in the development environments, not available in production, but when required, you can actually extend the operating units yourself. So now we know we have the internal organizations in the system. Also for the internal organizations, we can create organization relationships between them as part of an organization hierarchy. So difference between the party relationships and the organization relationships is the party is just an internal reference, and you can make some connection between one company and another company, or different persons. And for the internal organizations, you can define a certain hierarchy where you can model your business based on legal entities and operating units. And as you see, the team itself is a bit more faded now. It's a bit different color. And I don't know if it's also on your screen a bit lighter. But the teams cannot be used in organization hierarchies. So there's only the legal entities and operating units. And for each organization hierarchy we can build in the system, there is a link possible to link the organization hierarchy to a certain purpose in the system. And the purpose could be related to several features in the system. And I will explain about that one later and also provide some examples. Now, organizations, in fact, what you can do is model your organization, create also even more organization hierarchies, more than one, where you can look at your organization from multiple perspectives. So one is probably based on regions and legal entities. Another one might be more what's the relation between the departments and the cost centers. And you can create all kind of mixtures in that. One important thing, and also very powerful, is that the organization hierarchies are data effective. That means that you can actually plan organization changes in the organization hierarchies. For example, when tomorrow there will be a new legal entity in the system, then today it's not visible to business users, but as of tomorrow, you can actually set the system to also include all the features and select that legal entity or what type of organization expansion can be used. Also, when you are using the data effective, the patterns, when you do publish an organization hierarchy, in that case, you have to be a bit careful and take care of the planning. You can only publish an organization on one date, one organization hierarchy change on one date. So that means that if you made a mistake and you want to republish it on the same date, that's not possible. It should be a date, a physical date later than the last date used already in the system. I'll come back to that one a bit later as well. And because there are several purposes in the system, there's also some support on several features in the application, how to take advantage of building such a model structure in a system. I will also later on tell the link with financial dimensions, and also Jokas yesterday in his presentation, he talked about organization hierarchies and the link with account structures. I will repeat it a bit for those who were not in the sessions yesterday or missed the session from Jokas, but it's also really powerful and valuable. And also, if you did create a certain view on the dimensions like the cost center, business units, and departments, you can also use that one as a reporting tree in management reporter. And at that, the extensibility, you can extend the purpose in the system, but you can also extend the internal organization types to have more diversity in the system. But that last one is not applicable to human resources. In human resources, you don't have access to the development environment. You can't deploy a new package. So over there, it's not possible to extend it or even try out the demo I will do at the end of this presentation. The difference, main difference between the organization hierarchies and the position hierarchies, if you look at the organization hierarchies, it's all based on internal organizations. So it's about companies or different organizational units in the system. And the position hierarchy is based on the positions where persons are linked. So that's a real different in concept. Organization hierarchy can be used for different purposes, like centralized payments, or you can use it in the security. I'll come back to that one later. And the position hierarchy is mainly used for viewing all kind of data or the organization parts in system based on the positions, but also it's used for assigning workflows, like someone should approve a vendor invoice, and then the next step would be also his manager. I'll show you a demo how to maintain the hierarchy in the system and what you can do with that. And I just take one, and this one is from the talent, but the screens are exactly the same. If we go to the organization hierarchies, we can take, for example, the auto business unit. Initially, we can click view on what is created in this organization hierarchy. And in this case, if you look at the first one, it's called auto. That is a business unit in the system. The second layer is all based on departments, and the third layer is based on the cost centers. You always have one main node to be created. If you want to add new items in the system, you have to go to the edit part. The system will also show you if with an arrow if there's more in this hierarchy compared to what would be fit on the screen. So what you can do is also click the arrow and you'll see the next departments in the system, or go back. And in AX2012 it was more flashy, where also the whole hierarchy turned around, and I really loved that animation, but unfortunately it's just now on the left, the right, and that's all. If you want to focus on a certain level more in detail, for example the operations, then we can select that one and see what are the different cost centers in this case related to this one, and we can also focus on a cost center. What I will do now is edit this one and add some cost centers related to the sales and marketing department. then highlight the sales and marketing, and we can click insert, choose for cost center, for example, and the cost center might be online, which should be added, and another one will be central. And we're not limited to these three levels. We can also go a level deeper in the marketing campaign and also add, for example, legal entities or a value stream, what's in the system. So you can define a thing yourself. You can choose to start with legal entities, or you can choose to start with a department. That's all up to you. It's how you want to model your database. Now, when you want to go out and continue later, then it's possible to just close the screen, click edit again. Oh, there's a one. Your first view, then edit. And what I forgot now is saving my changes on purpose. So go to sales and marketing to really have the changes saved. In this form, it's one of the view in the system, we have to click the save button as well. When we now close the screen and view again, we don't see the new cost center added yet. But if we click on edit, it will ask now, do you want to continue working on the draft you did not publish yet, or do you want to delete the draft and start with a fresh one? Now I will continue working on the draft now. In that case, also the mall will be available. We got some feedback that we also have to add the outlet store again. Check if it's the correct one. Yes. And when we have done all the changes and it is complete, we can click on the publish button and the publish. Then we have to choose the effective date, also for what time zone, and we can provide some additional notes. What are the changes here? So if you want to have an effective date, you can choose to any date you like, unless it is later than the date mentioned in the text above. So as it is, the previous version was published in 2012. So if you do any date in 2013 or later, that will be okay. If we want to have this one effective as of tomorrow, then we can select the 1st of June and click on publish. But note, if you have clicked the publish button and you need to make a change which is on the same date or before your new effective date, that's not possible. So that would mean that you would have to choose another date. So when you plan to change or publish your organization hierarchies, make sure that you have everything before you click the publish button. Also, I think I want to plan something already for the 1st of July. And then something happens in June and you have to change it. That's not possible. So really be careful and don't make changes too far ahead. I'll click the publish button now. It has been published. And as mentioned, it is all date effective. So if we go in the view again, initially today it's not valid to have the additional cost centers active in this hierarchy, but we can see what are the changes in the system. When we want to view the next one, we can click view and then they will be added in this view as well. Now back to the presentation. Then we can start talking about the purposes and the supported features in this system. There's quite a list of them, and the documentation on AX2012 used to be a bit more sophisticated to learn about what is the real purpose of that. To be honest, I don't have experience on all of them myself, only those which will be highlighted now. So what I will do is talk a bit about the centralized payments and securities and the project management as examples in this presentation, because we also don't have time to really talk about everything in the system. But if you have a purpose set on a project management or decentralized payments, then the organization hierarchies should only contain legal entities in the system. The project management is used to be able to quickly view transactions or change the view of the all projects list page to be able to see also projects from other legal entities. So you have one combined view for all projects in your organization instead of per legal entity. The centralized payments, that one is a bit funny, because some people think they need to set up centralized payments purpose before they actually can start to work with the centralized payments. And for information, centralized payments means that there are several legal entities in the system. Also, like Joop has mentioned yesterday, where he had an example of one legal entity which is doing the finance and a lot of real estate companies where they track some changes. In those scenarios, there might be the case that all those real estate companies don't have an own bank account and that there's one company doing all the payments in a centralized way for all those legal entities. What you can do today without using decentralized payments is enable the option when you generate a payment proposal to also include transactions from other legal entities. When you then open the advanced query form, you can select manually which legal entities should be included in that payment. I will show that one quickly now. So when we go to the accounts payable of vendor journal, go to the lines, then we can create a new payment proposal. And to be able to do the centralized payments, we have to include the vendor invoices from other legal entities. When we have enabled that option, we can go to the filter, go to the company range, and select which legal entities. That part is working without the centralized payment purpose. Now, what is the centralized payment purpose doing for you? As you can see, some of the companies are already selected, like the DEMF, the USMF, and the USRT. If you create an organization hierarchy with the purpose of decentralized payments, it will recognize that this company, USMF, is one of the companies in that organization hierarchy. Then it will find all other legal entities in that same organization hierarchy and will mark them also in this find a payment proposal as pre-selection. So that would be the advantage if you are using centralized payments purpose, that you don't have to think or care about the company range yourself. That will be done by the system, thanks to the organization hierarchies. Also do a demo with the purpose for a security. In the demo environment, there are about 25, 26 legal entities divided all around the world. We have some US companies, there are some European companies in Japan, and even Saudi Arabia and Mexico. What you can do is create an organization hierarchy based on a kind of the line of business the company is doing, like retail or manufacturing or some consulting work. But it's also possible to create an organization hierarchy where you say, I want to have a kind of visualization for the continents and the countries in the world before having the real legal entities. And then it would be possible to just click on a certain node like North America, and a person should have access to a certain role, like the sales clerk, for all companies, legal entities in North America. That would include Canada, the USA, Mexico, for example. I'll show you what I've done over there. And first of all, I'll show you the organization hierarchy I created for this purpose. If you look at the, where is it, security part, I created a new hierarchy called Contoso Enterprises. Then I started with the world, then all the continents I could find on Wikipedia, so North America, South America, Europe, Africa, Asia, Australia. And if we drill down to Australia, Asia, for example, then we do have India, China, Japan, and below each country, there's a Contoso company included. Now, if you go to a certain user where we want to grant access to a certain security role, or start from the role itself, for example, with the accounts receivable clerk, you can see Arnie is having access as accounts receivable clerk, but I also want to assign some organizations. If we don't do it like the demo setup, then this person will have access to all legal entities in the system, but to be able to restrict that person for having the accounts receivable clerk role only effective for some legal entities, we can or assign the legal entities one by one based on the list of all legal entities in the system, and then grant, search the next one, grant, etc. But we can also select one of the hierarchies set as the purpose for the security, and in this case I will choose the Contoso Enterprise. Then we can start with the world, North America. We can drill down further what are the legal entities in part of the USA or North America. And if we say I want to have it access to all legal entities in the continent North America, we can right click and grant with children. That means there will be only one record that says based on the region North America and the hierarchy, the Contoso Enterprise, this user should have access to all legal entities you can find as part of North America. And you can see at the right side a list of those legal entities for your own reference, but it will show you only five and not all of them. I have been working on an implementation several years ago. There was the company doing client accounting for their customers, and they had in that environment over 2,500 legal entities. And we did a bit similar approach here for the internal accounting or the internal organization for the country. In the countries, we had one similar to this one, and we also had one organization hierarchy where we included all legal entities part of a certain country where they had been able to get access to do client accounting, and that was just granting access to one node, and in that case a user could have access to, for example, 400 legal entities at once instead of assigning them one by one. Now, what happens if we also plan to have a new legal entity effective as of the 1st of July, when a user will log in the future, then automatically that new legal entity will also be part of his security role. go back to the presentation. Next to the purposes defined in the system, there's also support for some financial features. So what already explained, we can use the row definitions for reporting, but we can also create some dimension relationships, just like shown before in the human resource environment. There could be a relation between the departments and the cost centers. And for your reference, the left picture, that's a screenshot from AX2012 environment. So you can see, in fact, the same information is there, but the look and feel is different. I'll show you a demo for the relationships as well. First, we have to go to the organization hierarchies again. Because what I did do is prepare the auto business unit one. And click on view. You can see today there are only two cost centers related to the sales and marketing, but already planned for tomorrow, starting tomorrow, there will be three new cost centers related to the sales and marketing department. To be able to use the relations between the, in this case, departments and the cost centers, we can go to the account structures in the system. And I did do a setup on the manufacturing P&L. Initially, it looks like everything is allowed here, but using the setup relationships, we can mark there's a relationship between the departments and cost centers according to the organization hierarchy auto business unit. But the effects of this are already prepared a journal with two lines. Then we have to go to the general ledger. General journals. On the first line, I did not prepare anything, only entered a certain account. When we look at the lookup, initially there's an option to select all cost centers, all departments and business units until you make more selections which are already prepared on the second one. Click on the account, look up where the cursor is on the cost center part, then it will automatically already show the possible values available. So we can now choose, for example, the 007 or 008 cost center, because those are related to the department 022, the sales and marketing. But that was as of today. When we change the journal date to a date in June or later, and then do the lookup and go to the cost centers, what we see is that the three new cost centers based on the organization hierarchy are visible now. So they are not valid today, but as of tomorrow for the journal postings, they are valid to be used in the system. So it's quite powerful to have these relations, because in this case you don't have to maintain the account structures when there are changes. You only have to publish a new version of the organization hierarchy to be able to get new valid combinations effective in the system. The next part is the hierarchies as a framework. As we have seen, there is an option to define internal organization types, and I did not show you where you can actually maintain your internal organizations, but there's a form in organization administration called operating units. And here we have all cost centers, region, retail channels, etc. When we click a new one, we can choose what we want to create, every type of operating unit, and as mentioned, the branch, the rental location, and the regions. Those are the three belonging to the fleet management, which are not available for a production environment. So if you need a kind of region or country operating unit type, in that case, you have to extend the enumeration in the system, and then it would be possible to create new operating units. And each new operating unit type can also be used as a financial dimension in the system. So we can, for example, create a new region, and it could be Italy, as that was not available yet. So the options with what operating unit types are available, that's based on an enumeration which is set to be extensible by Microsoft. So you can extend the options for this selection. And the same is valid also for the purposes. If you go to the organization hierarchy purposes, then you can see a lot of purpose already in the system. But if you create a new enumeration value as extension, then it's also directly possible to use an new purpose in the system, and you should do some development efforts to really implement it where you want to use it. Also, initially when AX2012 was released, then I did do some deep dive in several topics. What was new in AX2012? Well, the security was completely different compared to AX2009. There was a concept of the organization hierarchies in the system, all other cool different things in the system. And then I was thinking, well, how can I combine the internal organization types, not legal entities, but more organization types like several departments or cost centers, then use that information, link it to a user in a certain way, and then also limit the records using the security framework. But to be able to achieve that, you should have some development skills and an overview of what is in the system. The extensible data security that was introduced in AX2012 as replacement for the record level security. And it's based on creating a base query, create a security policy out of that query, and then you are a bit good to go and create one or more constraint tables to that one. I forgot about the next slide, so I already explained a lot of them what I wanted to tell. But next to the record level security, which was available until AX2009, and it was a bit of present in AX2012, but it was already deprecated. So in AX65, there's no record level security anymore. But instead of hiding, it also had support now to limit the creation, update, and delete of certain records. So a person could be able to see all records, but only change the customers belonging to his department, for example. That's what would be feasible with extended data security. I'm not going to explain this slide today. What happens in the back is if you do have a certain primary table, the XCS framework will look at what kind of policies and a context. Is it set to a certain role or application-wide, or probably part of a certain piece of coding where the extensible data security should be applied? If that's the case, it will take the standard query on a form or on a report or whatever, and the AOS itself will then add the query part. So that means, for example, where custable the table group is set to 20, could be one of the queries. And in that case, the user will only see all the customer records related to the customer group 20. And what I did in my example, I took the operating unit type retail channels, created, there are already some organization hierarchies related to the retail channels by department or by region, etc. And I thought, well, I want to use those retail organizations, link it to a certain security role, and then in that case, everything that has been assigned using the security framework should be visible for the user only. So I'll go and demonstrate that one now. For the security, we do have, for example, the retail source by business unit and by region. We'll take the upper one as example. This one has been divided in the types electronics, sporting, and fashion, and each each type has its own retail stores linked in the application. I have to go to another session, and I thought I already had it available. Yes, there's another session for Chris. When Chris initially opens the application without any security part, Chris is a retail operations manager in the system. Don't have access to all the features, only that one what is available for him. And initially, when we don't do anything related to the security part and the organization hierarchies and the extensible data security, this user will see all retail stores, all call centers in the system, and all online stores, but also via other menu items like the all stores. There's visibility on all of them. So we want to restrict this and go back to the session where I'm the administrator, and I'm going to restrict him now. System administrator, users, I'll find Chris, because Chris is not allowed to view all the organizations. So for the retail operations manager, I want to assign some organizations. That's in this case not based on the legal entities, but the retail stores by business unit. It will not only show the legal entities which are in the system, but all internal operating types. So it will also show you the electronics and all the legal entity or the retail channels part of that one. What we'll do is now assign the sporting, which has some of the retail channels, and in addition also add Boston separately. So what you can see is just like the security of legal entities, you'll see the sporting has been assigned including hierarchy and the Boston as a separate one. Unfortunately, it's not recognized at the right side in your information pane, because that's only showing the legal entities. So if you also want to show the business unit and the retail channels, that would require another customization here. When we have assigned this one to the user, go back to the session from Chris. Initially, he has access to a lot of them. When we refresh the screen now, so log in again, you'll see that the list is a bit shorter. Well, if you don't believe me, this is quite a large one, so I'll change it quickly. One which is having some less stores, then it will be the electronics. And when looking at the sporting at Miami, for example, separately. Go back to the session from Chris again. Refresh, and you'll see that he has only access to certain retail channels now, and that same applies also when he goes back to his own workspace. So you see only the stores here, and also there was another wrong device click for me. Yes, does not have access to any call center in the system, and there's only one online store related to his responsibilities now. I'll not go into details how it has been done, but a quick overview for the ones who are interested. And if you want to know more about it, I wrote a blog in the past, and you can also download this exact same example. If you install it, then it's working directly after a build. It has one table containing all operating units related to the organization assignments, which is populated because of an XCS method on this temporary table. The Express Plus coding, I'm not going to explain it in detail, but this will look at the direct assignments, so which operating units are assigned as one-on-one, and also one related with a hierarchy. We'll put it in the temporary table for this user, and that table will be used in a query where we can have the retail channel table as main table, then my retail channels as an inner join, so that will cause the limitation of what he can see. And as last part, the security policy itself, where it was said that the retail channel should be restricted for all operations, so he's not allowed to do anything with other retail channels, only those which are assigned to him. And there's another constraint table, the retail store entity, which is in fact the data entity related to the system. So also via the Excel add-in, he is able to see only the retail store's part of his responsibility. And the constraint tables, the list can be extended with all kind of retail transactions and other views in the system. And that's what I didn't do in my demo. It was just to explain how we can use the security framework XCS and internal organization hierarchies to secure access to individual data records in the system. That was about the hierarchy and XCS itself. Then the next one will be up to questions. I will skip it first. There are also some useful links. I will also put them in the chat window or share the PowerPoint so you can click them, where you can find the documentation for standard finance operations and AX2012, and also a link to the blog how to use this example to do the security by retail channel. That's it for me for today. Then I wonder if there are any questions for me.
Thanks again, Andre. It looks as though, really, I think people have just been downloading all the knowledge you've been sharing, really. It looks as though people maybe are looking to understand where to begin with hierarchies based on the fact that there's not been that much. I mean, Zahir has got some interesting feedback related to your session. He's mentioned that the XDS has been asked for in every retail project and is done as a customization. He's asking, could you please share a link where where this is, as it is now an essential part that's required. So if you could share anything related to XDS.
Yes, I created several blogs about XDS, the Extensible Data Security, and also did a presentation, or several times a presentation in the past about that that security framework. But I will put in the link to this particular example. And there is also in that blog a link to a more generic page for the XDS explanation examples I created, where you can find all details also related to an inventory site and warehouse security part. It can be downloaded and used as examples in any project. That's
excellent. Thanks for that. And also he continues, assuming human resources use a CDS to update FinOps with the dual right where Anna showed a manager seeking employees under him, I'm curious if the same hierarchy and dimension tables, including department cost center in HR.
Yes,
or,
in fact,
is it one direction where jobs positions are created in D365 HR as systems of record and then sent to FinOps, with FinOps hierarchy is in the FinOps only? But you're saying the first part is correct. Is that right?
In fact, if you look at human resources and financial operations, human resources has been extracted from the code base from finance operations and created as a separate SaaS offering. Microsoft continued to invest in new features and improvements in human resources, and they don't do anything that much anymore in finance operations related to human resources. What will remain in finance operations will be the workers, the positions, the hierarchies, etc. But they aimed to say human resource would be the first place where you enter all your data related to human resources, and that should be synced to finance and operations, and that's already possible today using the Dynamics Integrator. And Microsoft is also working on a story to have that integration between human resources, CDS, and also the dual right to have a dual right features from human resources also back and forth with finance operations. But
great stuff.
Expect that all new investments related to human resources will be done in human resources.
Right. And there's a question by Abdurrahman, which is, thanks, Andre, for the great presentation. I have one question. When we associate a business unit to a financial dimension and we want to bring up automatically the value on a sales order, can they copy the value from the user linked to the business unit directly?
Not sure if I do understand that question completely. I think this one on my screen now.
Can the SO, copy the value from the user linked to the BU? It's by Abdurrahman. That's his question. It's that one there, yeah. It's that question at 5:54.
If the question is related to the default dimensions used on the sales order and sales order lines, then the relation we created on the account structures is not applied on the default dimensions. To be able to do so, you need to apply a customization yourself. It's only supported out of the box for the journal entry, if that was the question.
Okay, thanks. Right, so we've got another 3 minutes for any remaining questions. So there's lots of thank you, Marius, saying thanks. Andre, Rajesh is saying it was a great session, thanks. Morgan is also thanking you. Zahir is also thanking you, as well as Cole. And Moritz Preller. So obviously everyone's thanking you. Ruiz, Diraj, saying brilliant session. Agdeniz, Van Heilst, and Bachu, and Vladimir, many, many thanks. Adolfo Castillo. Yep, we've got Spanwar. Yep, obviously Dr. Ludwig as well. So there's many, obviously everyone's thanking you. I think it was a very educational session. So people have been listening like students listening to their master, basically. So
yeah, thank you.
lots of knowledge learned there. And thank you for obviously sharing and transferring your expertise and knowledge on this subject matter. It's obviously a topic which the community are learning from. Thank you once again for going deep onto this matter and educating us all. So we've got obviously 2 minutes till our final session. So Andre, do you have any final messages for the community since you are so active? Do you have any final words for the community?
At least it was fun to see a lot of familiar names on the participants list today. Some of them I know from the community, a few of them I have met in person, but unfortunately not all of them. It's also awesome that a lot of people living in, for example, India and the eastern part of the world are staying up that late to listen to our stories. Also, thank you for staying up that late. And like me, sacrificing your weekend to learn from each other. And if you have any questions, definitely. Just reach out to me. And also, please use the Dynamic Communities forum for asking your questions.
So for those who don't know, it's community.dynamics365.com. That is the ultimate source that you need for all your knowledge. And Microsoft Learn and Docs, obviously. But believe it or not, guys, most of the information you need you will find there. So thanks again, Andre. Always a great pleasure to have you.
In fact, the community is a bit my second home. So.